And it's really nice to get an impression of Korea and the language and all the things. And I really enjoy myself. Okay, so Taco had a bit of a more technical talk about Lua, Tech, the project, and MPLib. And I will try to give you an impression, for as much as possible in 50 minutes, what the influence of Lua Tech on Context Mark IV is. Context is a macro package. I don't know how many people didn't know what exactly Context is, but let's say that you are a LaTeX user, which probably majority is. Context is a bit like LaTeX, or you can also say LaTeX++ or whatever, but it has everything integrated. It's a slightly different approach. And we have a special version of Context called Context Mark IV, which is the version that will exploit Lua Tech to the maximum. Let's give you a quick view of how a context file looks like. Taco already showed one. We have commands, as of course any Tech system has, and they're normally preceded by the backslash. And then we have arguments, often optional or not. We have key value pairs that set you things. And then we have the commands that you will probably recognize if you also use another system, chapter section. We can have itemized thingies and whatever. So in that respect, it's not so... Well, not this one. I can try to... Maybe... There's a bit of problem. My screen is normally... I normally have a bigger screen, so it's a bit... Where's my... Oh, here. I can make this one larger, I think. No, should be... Maybe there is... Okay, I just remembered there's one in here. But you see here, by the way, is and I have to use this editor even if I don't use it on a daily basis, because at least it shows Korean, which I will show later. This editor, TechWorks, is a project by Tech User Groups, which makes... the objective of the project is to have one editor for each platform.
This is the pointer.
Yep. Okay, so the idea is that with NextTech Live we can also ship an editor that can run on each platform and has an integrated PDF viewer and can handle all those languages. It's called TechWorks. I'm not directly involved in the project, but it might make sense for the user group here to keep an eye on it and, for instance, provide the information to give it a Korean user interface, because it could be handy. Okay.
Can you show the beginning part again?
Yeah, so TypeScripts are the way in context to define a font. So I choose Palantino, then I actually activate this font. I set up the white space a bit, I enable colors, chapter section, these are the normal commands. There's an itemize, later on we will see something in Korean. Another section. Here I include a little bit of Lua code. So we have a special command that permits you to include the Lua code. I input another text, I input a little bit of MetaPost code. There was the remark by Batjof about why use another language. Well, why? For me, I think MetaPost somehow, it makes it possible to express, at least in my case, often simple graphics in an easy way, and probably need 3 or 4 times as much code in Lua if I would have a Lua variant for that. Okay, so let's run this document and see what we get. So you see the PDF viewer is kind of integrated in the editor. So we get the document. We have the chapter section, there was the itemize. Here is the code that was actually generated by Lua. So we have a loop. This is like any language, it has a loop construct, we print something to tech. So we are inside Lua, and we print something to tech, and what we print is a piece of text where we concatenate the loop counter, and we also concatenate the par command, so that tech can go to the next paragraph. Where was my screen here? So here you see indeed 10 times sample, sample 1 to sample 10. Here's a little bit of MetaPost code. So just to give you an idea in context, it's an integrated system. You don't have to load anything. It comes more or less comes for free. You don't have to load a package that is MetaPost or Lua or whatever. It's all there. Okay, back to the main presentation. It's very important if you look at the project to keep in mind that we don't implement solutions. We only provide a way to implement your own solutions. The reason for this is very simple. Imagine that you have this room full of techies and they need to agree upon how to extend tech. Well, you can forget about it. They can argue forever and everyone has a different opinion and there will never be an extension. So what we decided was a different approach. We said, well, let's just make the engine, the core engine, tech engine, extendable and use for this the Lua language, which is a language which is explicitly meant for extensions. Well, because Taco and I both use context and are also the authors of context, we use context as a test bed for implementing many, many mechanisms from scratch. And this is really a drastic thing. It means that we throw away lots of code and we implement it completely newly. A simple first attempt on using Lua was by just using it as an A-scripting language. Nothing special. Nothing special always relating to tech. I'll give an example of that. Again, you see here a bit of context code. Somehow it doesn't like to remember the font size. Okay. So I have a module called CalcMask, which permits me to include mathematics in a different way as in tech. This is the way you enter mathematics in, for instance, Texas Instrument Calculator, which is used in Dutch schools. So this is why we also call it school math. Yeah. And what happens is that this piece of text is fed into Lua. If I process it, you get this. Yeah. So it looks reasonably tech, so to say. And if I open, I'll have to. Just to give you an idea, don't try to understand the code. About the amount of code involved, yeah, this is Lua code. There's a lot of string substitutions going on. Oh, why is this? I have to be very careful. Okay, so it ends more or less here. This is 170 lines of code that takes this input, this Texas Instrument Calculator input, turns it into something tech that is then typed. So it means that you can, because everything runs inside the tech engine, you don't need an external program or whatever to do it. So that was one of the first things that I started playing with, and then when that was, well, kind of successful, we entered more or less a stage where Taco, Hartmut, etc. got involved, and we had something like, well, let's just start extending tech itself. A rather drastic step in the context Mark IV code is that we completely abandoned the traditional way of locating files. There's the Capaci library, which is responsible for locating files in the tech tree. But it is a long-standing wish that we could also read from zip file sockets, web pages and whatever. So the first thing I did was completely re-implement the file searching and I/O mechanisms. And it means that in context we can now read from zip files, we can typeset stuff that is located on some HTTP server, or it can fetch stuff from a FTP server, typeset it, things like that. And you just do that in your document file. So if you want to include a graphic that is located on some machine, you can just do so. Another important change was it's definitely something that happens here, is that you can have specific kind of input encodings that needs to be translated to something else. Well, it's always a bit cumbersome to do that in tech, and in Lua it's often a few lines of code and using a translation table to do the same thing. So that was also completely replaced and implemented. Then, in the next stage, think like verbatim, typically tech thingies, and then buffering. We have quite some buffering mechanisms. You can imagine the reason why we developed context was mainly for educational purposes. So we have complex documents where we have a large body of text with explanations and questions and answers and everything need to be moved around. And that kind of code was implemented completely in Lua. Metapost. There are several ways to deal with Metapost. In the beginning, we just took the graphic, the output of the graphic data, converted it to PDF. But nowadays, we just take it directly from the library and we get a kind of data structure which represents the graphic and we convert it to something PDF that we inject into the stream. The nice thing is that we get depending on the kind of graphics you have, easily can get a throughput of 10 to 20,000 graphics per second compared to, at most, a few per second in the previous situation. Rather important change is the way we deal with fonts. If you look at traditional tech, it can only handle fonts with 256 characters. And this is reflected everywhere in the system. It means that if you set up a font system, even in let's say Europe, where we have, let's say, the Latin script, it is a problem. Because if you want to combine several European languages, and I'm not even talking of combining with Russian, but just the normal European language, you can already run out of characters if you have 256 characters. So all macro packages are somehow crippled by the fact that they need internally to do all kinds of tricky things to make sure that you can access all these characters. Another good example is mathematics. Yeah? In mathematics, we have many symbols. And if you have only 256 slots in a font, you need many fonts, and in some way to combine many fonts in order to get access to all these symbols. And because LuaTeX is UTF-8 and Unicode, and the fonts can be large, well, you can re-implement it all that. Now, you must imagine that somebody like me who has spent, maybe 10 or more years on making this macro package, and you have spent of that a considerable amount of time making font mechanisms that can deal with all these issues, that there is of course some sentiment involved in making this transition. It means that you have to throw away lots of code. And things that 10 years ago took me maybe months to implement, I can now implement in weeks. And you throw away all this code. And this is why it's a really drastic thing what's happening now. LuaTeX project, for instance, if other macro packages like LaTeX, for instance, really want to use LuaTeX in the way we mean to use it, it means a major rewrite. It means throwing away 50 to 75% of the code and write it new. And of course, you feel sorry about this code. Well, most of this code is bad code, messy code, crappy code, because it has to deal with things that tech originally was not written for. Donald Knuth wrote tech for handling English and making his own books. And, well, look at Korea, where we have a completely different situation. All OpenType, because we're talking about OpenType 2-type fonts, handling is done in Lua. even the traditional type 1 fonts no longer use the TFM files. I just read the AFM files and make the data structures myself. So this is also quite some consequence, because it means that all things related to font encoding are just gone. Okay, and I will draw something on the screen first. Say that this is your input, the key in ABC. Internally in tech, you will get this, a glyph node, which points to an A. And there's also a reference to a font. These are three glyph nodes. And if you eventually make it into some text, it might become an HBox. But it doesn't look like that, then there is something pre-printed that tells that this is an HBox. So we have a linked list of nodes. At least in tech we call them nodes. Now imagine that you, and this is something, well, I don't think it probably happens to Korean, but in Latin script related languages, you sometimes say, I want to make this lowercase string into an uppercase one. Huh? Now, doing that in tech is close to impossible, especially if you have special encodings, because, well, you never know what happens in the meantime. If you say, I want to make this whole text uppercase, and say that in this text you have commands like this, you have a command like this, and it suddenly becomes uppercase, then you have a problem. Yeah? This needs to be only to be applied to the ABC that finally ends up in your document. So one of the things that you can do in LuaTeX is shift all the things that you normally do on the input to the internal machinery. You have an internal representation, a linked list of glyph nodes in this case, and there you can do all kinds of action. They say, wait a minute, I see an A and it should be a lowercase a. And you just change the reference to the glyph in the font. And that's a rather drastic change. That's what I mean. All the old code, you throw it away, you write something new, it looks completely different. We can convert virtual fonts at runtime. I will show later how you can use that kind of stuff for instance, for Korean kind of things. We can have fallback fonts, more or less use the same mechanism. Taka already mentioned that we have attributes. In traditional tech, there's only one attribute, the font. At some point you say we have a character, it points to a font, so the font is an attribute, and the pointer to a font is, well, you can also consider it to be an attribute. So how did we in the past implement color? If you wanted color, you say that you want green B. What you did was you put some special command there in between. It's also called a special. And it says, I want this to be called. For instance, in PDF code, it looks like this. If it should be blue, it influences your breaking, it influences your spacing, it influences all the things that you don't want it to influence. Now, with attributes, we do differently. We say there can be many attributes, and we can define a color attribute and say, okay, attribute 25, if it has the value 123, it means go blue. So the bee gets an attribute. And it means at some stage later in the process, in Duotech, for instance, just before the ship out, you can look at this list and you can loop over the list and then see what you can do with this special, based on this special attribute. And it means that it cannot interfere anymore. And it also means that your whole column mechanism has to be re-implemented, of course. One of the other things that I'm currently playing with, but there are some limitations in the engine currently, is vertical spacing. Vertical spacing is always a problem. In tech, you have a model for skipping and a model of penalties. And as soon as you start combining these things, well, not all situations are so controlled, so you can have situations where you think that you really prevented something to end up on the same page, but it still ends up on the next page, and then you have to fight tech really hard. And these are things that we think that we can, again, improve by just, you take this page, and just before you define it to be a page, you just look at it and say, wait a minute, this is not a page, let's put it aside and do something different with it. You can really, in each stage of tech, you can intercept it. Another important change is that mathematics is now Unicode mathematics. It means that we can use Unicode fonts. I will also show that. I think the only real example is, how many people here are using MS Windows? Nobody. That's a pity, because on MS Windows you have the Cambria font, which is a rather nice mathematical font. It also sets the standard. I think that Microsoft, by cooking up the Cambria font plus the OpenType extensions, more or less set the standard of how we are going to deal with miles in the future. And Duotech can handle these fonts. And that really simplifies our life, as I will show. We have re-implemented XML handling. So traditionally, if you know a bit about XML, there are two ways to process it. You can have a stream-wise processing. You see something and you act upon it. And the other approach is that you look at XML as a tree and you act upon the tree. You can filter things, you can maybe even change things, whatever. In context, we now use the tree-based approach. So we can just load this big XML document and manipulate it in any way and filter it in any way we want, just by using more or less XPath-like commands. There's a new image library. So you should just keep in mind, tech never does anything with image. Tech and image is just a black box. It has dimensions. PDF tech slide goes a bit further, because it internally has some knowledge about its images, but even then, for the typesetting engine, it's just dimensions. There's an image library which is completely separated from the rest that you can use to identify and to some extent manipulate things. What I've done recently is to re-implement all the structure-related things. You all know that when you have tech typesetting a document, that things like table of contents has to be stored in some file and called upon the next time that you run tech. Well, this is also true for context. And what we have done now is, instead of storing the stuff in some tech file, just store it in big Lua tables. And it means that you can carry a lot of information around for the second run, and you can do way more clever things like index sorting and reuse of data and whatever. This is a rather drastic measure. It may mean to waste throwing away lots of code. So it might not be clear from an average run, but last time that we did some timings, we found out that macro package like context already spends some 50 to 75% of its time in Lua. We mean the file searching, font handling, all kinds of things. And more tech is just doing what it can do best, is typesetting. No fancy thing like parsing and handling things that it was originally not really made for. Okay, so this is kind of overview of the consequences of Lua Tech for context. Couple of example files I can show you. Let's run this one first. I mentioned mathematics, just to give you an idea in what direction we are moving. This is the Cambria fault. The reason why you see color is that what we do is we get a mass formula, and in context it enters an analyzer. So we first analyze the mass. We take care of some alphabet changes that are needed, depending on what the user asks. But it also gives us some nice way of tracing. So these are, for instance, extendable symbols. This is a root, and we can recognize these thingies. What you see at the bottom is quite some alphabets. Watch at the next page. That's more green. Yeah, everything green is not directly supported by fonts. So the Cambria is a way more complete font than Latin Modern, where you see, for instance, only a few scripts, and it's hard to see, but you can see it here. There are only a few facture characters and a few scripts. Cambria is much more complete. There's much more characters in it. One of the projects that's underway is that there will be a Latin Modern mass variant, which is also open type. Now, one of the things, nice things about Lua, Lua Tech is for following. Let's first close a couple of documents. What you would like to do is to make life for the user easier. Maybe you remember that, I don't know how often it happens here, but in the Netherlands it happens quite a lot. Let's make this one bigger. If you have this kind of coordinate pairs, you often need to do this kind of things in order not to get the space after the comma. Yeah? I don't know how many mathematicians are fighting this problem here, but this is something annoying. However, if you look at the example, you will notice that there is no space after the comma. And this is because, let's go back here, I've built in an option called auto punctuation. And what it does is it enables a bit of code in the context engine, so to say, that automatically tries to detect if you have this situation where a number, comma, number takes place, and it changes a little bit. I can show you the code. Where it sits. Yeah, this is actually quite even a lot of code, but it gives you slightly an idea. What I do is, I set an attribute, and the attribute tells, okay, wait a minute, this piece of code, as long as this attribute is set, I need to take care of this space that I don't want there. So there is some attribute checking going on. And nodes is the, just like we have a list of glyphs, we can have a list of mass nodes. Now, don't try to understand the code, but it gives you an idea about what happens. Yeah, there is some 15 lines of code that goes to the list and say, wait a minute, I have something character here followed by an ordinal followed by another character. So I need to give it, to change it into punctuation, and that's what actually happened here. Of course, it assumes that you know a bit about how Tech internally works with mathematics, but that's normally not what you should be worried about. That's what macro writing should be worried about. But at least it gives you an idea about what we can expect. There are some things in tech that are hard to solve now, but because we can look at a formula completely different ways, we can try to solve them in different ways. Another example of, for instance, Korean is might be a rather demanding language if we talk about tech. Now we'll think about Arabic. If you have this kind of input, in order to get this result, yeah, so we have something that is completely stacked, you start with this. This is what the user inputs. Yeah? So the user inputs this, and we have a complete tracer built in to get this kind of information. And then an open type font can define all kinds of features to be applied to this sequence. It starts decomposing the stuff. And we get this. Then it starts replacing. So we get this. And between each step you might see slightly different situation. Yeah, so this is quite different between this one and this one, because here it already starts moving up things. Yeah? And this one is still not okay, so the font has information about where to move this thing to. Now it's moved up. And there's even a final stage which takes care of very detailed position of these things. So this kind of manipulations are all done in Lua. And it means that you take this node list, just to give an idea why we get this 50% time spent in Lua. You have this list, and there are, especially for fonts like Arabic or Palantino, you easily have a couple of hundred loops over the list for each glyph, so you have 10,000 loops, yeah, that need to look up things in the font, replace things, etc., etc. We are talking about millions of operations on a node list like that in order to get it in this shape. It also gives you an idea that the language, that there's quite some, the language like Lua should be fast. Well, Lua is fast. We can only do this kind of thing because Lua is so fast. Okay, let's now move on to something Korean. I'm no expert in Korean, but I've made a few examples, also based a bit on discussions the last few days, about how you can normally deal with this kind of things. You didn't give me the list. And so Taco and I had to find out ourselves. We probably did it in the wrong way, so any error is yours. Okay, when we were looking at examples, we were wondering why do Korean people use 1, 2, 3, 4 in itemized list and not some nice Korean symbol? Because in the museum that we visited, we saw these symbols being used, so we thought it should be possible. Okay, just to give you an idea about what Lua does and what Tech does. This is Unicodes. So what I've done is, part of this is built on top of existing infrastructure and context. I have a languages use a namespace, and within that a counters namespace. I'll have to make it a bit bigger, yeah? Not make it too big. Okay. So this is a table, basically. This is a table, so, and I create, in this table, I create a new entry. It's an hash. I call it Korean. We have taken this from Unicode. These are just Unicode points. And I create another one. The P is for parentheses. There's another list in Unicode as parentheses, and the C is for circled. Yeah? So I make a few synonyms, There's just some technical issue. I think I should make the font slightly smaller. Okay. Then I define a just a context commander. You know, there is in Tecto something like Roman numerals. You might know that. Well, there is no Korean numerals in Tech, so we have to really make it ourselves. It takes one argument, being a number, and then I call Lua. I have a shortcut for that, CTX Lua, just calls Lua. And it calls a function that I already made called alphabetic. It takes a number, this is the argument passed, and it will use Korean, yeah, it will use this one, to convert. So 1 becomes this one, 2 becomes that one, 3 becomes that one. And when I run out of numbers, I start new. Yeah. Then, and this is the context part, I define a conversion, KR, Korean numerals, KRP, etc., etc. And now I can use an itemize. Now you should forgive me, if this is probably, well, I copied it from you, but I think I lost a space somewhere. I copied it from your mail. Yeah, there should be a space in there, yeah? No?
No
space? No space, it's okay, okay. Okay. Well, because I was working in another editor and it didn't show Korean, so I don't know if I messed it up. This can go away. Okay, so if I process this, so I have an itemize. I showed you at the beginning this command. I had defined a converter, KR. And I can just call it. Let's see what we get. Just to, you see, it's not 5 minutes to get this one. And this, to me, this looks like Korean. Yeah. So it's not so difficult to extend a machinery like context to support languages like this. Okay, second example, we will be a bit more ambitious. Let's see, is this still readable? Yeah. Okay, I have the same code here. Yeah. But I want to go a bit further. I also want my section headers at the second level to be done this way and this way. As far as I understood, there are some conventions. I think it was not completely clear what the conventions were, but that I would like to know if there's somebody here who uses context or want to use it, just tell me what I should do so that I know what's needed. Okay, now we will do some font stuff. And this is a bit the way fonts are done in context. What we do is we always use more or less symbolic names. So we have, we don't talk about let's say in this case Ubuntu, or we talk about Serif. We have a Serif font. And it happens to use, in this case, the Ubuntu. The Serif bold here. Problem is that we, if I make it slightly smaller, it looks better. Still not on one line. Okay. Then there is Serif, Serif Bold, Serif Italic. I couldn't find an italic one. So we just map it on the Serif and the Bold. Italic, we map it on the Bold. Although I have seen italic Korean fonts somewhere. Yeah, I think it was in the museum or whatever that we saw, but it seems to happen. Now, forget for the moment about this. Yeah. If we have that kind of definition, we can define a typeface, which is more or less a font collection in context, say, and we call it Korean. We map it on Roman, because that happens to be the category internally that we map the serifs on. And serif and some Korean will be used as filters. So we have serif, some Korean. Yeah. We have, at the same time, we have a sans some Korean. And that's the undotum and undotum bot. Now, let's see what happens if we process this document. Yeah, there's a bit of text here. So what happened here is that there were a couple of fonts loaded. As you can see, we have a sans in the heading. We have this numbering is replaced by something that looks nice. And we have a piece of typeset text, we have the numeration, and we have some, well, some 100 times a section. The interesting thing is, by default, somehow it completely dead. Look, you're back again. This is always things. Should we start duplicating the thing? So it's like in Latin, A B A C, or should we? So that's debatable what we can do. Now, if you look here, you will see that this, what we have here between parentheses, is not in the same font. If you would look in order, you could see what the document fonts are. We used Palantino, and actually we use a Palantino Nova. If you see here, the test is not in the same font as the Unfonts, it's in the Optima Nova, which is also one of Herman Zapp's fonts. It would be nice to have a Korean variant of the Optima Nova, actually. I think the font is pretty good, would look really good in that way. Okay, so how did we accomplish that? What I did here is, I defined, let's say, the serif, yeah, the umbantang, and I also defined a fallback. And this is a symbolic name, Korean serif fallback regular. Can be any name. Yeah? So just before I defined the typeface, I defined the fallback. I said this one has to take from Palantino Nova Lite using the default feature set, so you can use the features, the font features that belong to this font. You don't use the Ubuntu one because it probably doesn't have any features. Map anything what falls in that range and get it from that font. Do some checking, do some forcing, and use a relative scale. It should be slightly larger than the normal. You see here a slightly different scaling for the Optima Nova. So here we can create a complete set of fallbacks. If there would be Arab in there, you could choose in a similar way some. So let's say Arab type, and add Arabic support to this. So we ran this document just to give you an idea about the number of fonts you see here. There are quite some fonts being loaded. This is the Tech Pagella is here. It's hard to see here in this screen, but we need to load accompanying mass fonts. So a bunch of mass fonts is being loaded. We have, I think, one of the four Korean fonts, and we have a couple of Latin fonts. And because there were some complaints about runtime, just to give an ID, font load time in this run is 4 seconds. That's all font load time, so it also means initialization and other things. And you get a throughput of, in this case, 5 pages per second, because lots of graphics and other things. But the more you run, the more things per page you get. And memory consumption, there were also some discussions about memory consumption this week. For a run like this is 134 megabyte. So that's still acceptable, given that you load quite some fonts. Yeah? Okay, so there's the one thing that I want to show you. I don't know how much time do I have? 5 minutes, okay, so I'm a bit ahead of time. It would be nice if there would be Korean user interface. Now, there's absolutely no reason in Lourdes why you couldn't say this. Yeah? Now here I cheated a little bit because I use set value to define this, but if you run this you could see, where is it? At the end, yeah, we had some leftover chapter title, and it was this command that did it. Of course, it doesn't mean chapter, but I have absolutely no idea how to enter chapter in this editor. So how can we create, for context, this is only true for context, a Korean user interface? Well, that's not so hard. If you find somebody who is willing to do it. The chapter command, this is the chapter command. The complete user interface is defined in a neutral way. So this is the Czech name, this is the Dutch command, and this is the Persian one. There's no reason why there couldn't be a Korean entry there. Somebody just had to make the entries. And then you can have, I think it took the Persian guy maybe a day to do it. So in a day you can have a complete Korean context with all key values being done in Korean, all commands being done in Korean, etc. Just adding information to the table and defining a couple of things. And that's the user interface part. There's another file that could be interesting to see, just to give an idea about how we use Lua. One of the first thing I did is to starting to make one big table that has all the information. So doesn't matter what you take. Yeah. There's quite some information in one big table that you can also access from inside context. So it's technically possible to say, when I have this paragraph, I can make a very dedicated routine that runs over it and analyzes it and starts to improve things at a certain level. You can just convert the main Unicode table and see what the characteristics are of certain characters and character categories. So this might give you a bit of an idea about what Lua-Tech and Lua-Tech's impact is. Just to give you an idea, we have already some 5 megabytes of Lua code in context. I'm cheating a little bit because this is the user interface file, which is a big one, and this is the big character table, so we have some 3 megabyte character information. On the other hand, you can look, if you look at the font system, open type handling, easily takes 184 megabyte. Now, to come back to Korean, and this is where I need your help. Yeah, I don't speak the language. I like the clips, I like looking at it, and I'm willing to implement everything, but I'm not a linguist. What I did is last week I implemented a mechanism that works roughly as follows, but it might be that things are missing or things are wrong. Because I have to deal basically with 3 languages, if you talk about the CJK languages, there's Chinese, there's Korean, and there's Japanese. Chinese is, to some extent, Chinese is the most, is a bit messy, yeah? The rules are, well, depends a bit on who you talk to. In that sense, Korean is most close to what I'm accustomed to because it has spaces, yeah, which makes life really easier. Okay, so I have categorized the things in categories. All characters are categorized. This is a bunch of functions. And then there is a table which defined what should happen if you have two characters of certain classes next to each other. Like, what needs to be done when I have Korean next to Korean? Well, I have to insert a Korean break, which is penalty of -50, I'm told. But this... Well, 50 is positive, so 50 you never get a break then. It depends a bit. 50.
I intended a little discourage of hybrid between inside the Korean world.
Yeah, but then you then I think you also need to add a glue. Do you also add a glue then? Okay, this is debatable. Yeah, you can have. My idea is to give a system where you can have maybe 3, 4, 5 different ways of dealing with it. Because my experience until now is that there's always some. The same is true. How much should the space be? Yeah, they can simply discuss. So what I made is just a configurable system, and we can discuss the details. Yeah. Let's see. So this is the table. Or green break. Green break is a function. We can just redefine the function. Yeah? And there can be many injectors. Okay, so, and probably for Chinese we need a completely different set. And for Japanese, yet another one. So, what we then should do is at the beginning of the document set, listen, I'm going to be in Korean mode today, and I need to process this document with the Korean settings. The function itself that loops over the list is this one. This is the main loop. We loop over a list, yeah, just a while loop. We look at if we have a glyph, we do something, and then we keep track of stuff. And when we have collected enough information, we pass to another function, and that will apply all these things. Now, you don't need to understand this kind of stuff, but the main thing here is that we don't do it at the tech level. We do it at the moment where we know that we are dealing with characters, that we know what we have to deal with. Actually, at this stage, you could even consider doing things like changing forms or doing completely other things, but normally that's definitely needed. This loop, so the loop here, more or less forgotten what the name is of the command. Problem is that I run off my screen. My DOS box is too. So just to give you an idea, there are already quite some processes that take place on this list. I normalize fonts, I check for missing characters, which is another loop over the list. Character mirroring, which is needed for error, yeah, automatic mirror detection of that direction. Case swapping, breakpoint processing, and here language is CTK pre-processed, is hooked in here. So there are quite some actions that take place on the node list before actually something happens. After that we do hyphenation, kernel hyphenation if needed. There's a spell checker built in. We can do spell checking and color words that have the wrong colors. Then we get a lot of handling. This is the main character, open type feature character handling. Injecting kernels, protecting. There's a lot of things are just done in Lua. When everything is done, we have a similar thing that we hook into the ship out handler. We clean up the page, we handle all the colors, we deal with transparencies, own prints, all kinds of stuff there. And Mathematics has its own processor here. This is a top layer. I expect that there will be many more things like that. But at least give you an idea that a lot of things are happening. Well, this is a bit of the story.
질문하실 분